he comes, we'll see just a child, no warrior lord, but a baby's a mom. The Lord says, Bethlehem, though you are but small, in you shall be born the King. You shall cease. Men shall hammer their spears into pruning hooks and prepare for battle no more. When he comes, when he comes. And on that day, there will be laughter on that day. Joy ever after, no more tears, for the Lord will wipe them all away. And on that day, men shall be brothers reconciled to God and each other. The world shall see the King in his glory when he comes. When he comes. And his kingdom shall never cease. When he comes, when he comes.
Good morning. A very warm welcome to you to our service this morning. We are back here in St. Nicholas because of a bit of a heating problem in St. Machan, but you're all welcome to our service here this morning. And also a very warm welcome to you if you are watching the recording of our service later during the week online on Facebook or YouTube or the DVDs. We're glad to be able to welcome you also to the service. Today we also especially welcome some of our neighbours from Uphill South Parish Church. Unfortunately, on late Friday afternoon, a pipe burst in their church building, making it unsafe for them to use their building and to hold their services over the next few weeks. So we hope that you feel most welcome here with us this morning. And naturally, that will have some practicalities and some impacts on the arrangements that we've made for our upcoming joint services over Watch Night and Christmas. So a small group of us will meet tomorrow morning just to speak about all these practicalities and to discuss that. And we'll update you, both congregations and all our notices, Facebook and the website, as soon as we can after our meeting tomorrow morning. So as they say, watch this space. We'll have some updates in the coming week as well, just to make sure that everyone's aware of where all the services will take place over the next few weeks. Excuse me. Some other announcements for us just to take note of. The first one is just to say that this morning there'll be no teas and coffee served. So after the service, please go straight home and have a lovely cup of tea at home and keep yourself warm. So no teas and coffees after the morning service. Then this morning was the last early service for this year. The next early service that will take place will be on the 8th of January, and that's at 9:30 in Uphill South. So, well, we'll see if it's in Uphill South. I think that's also a watch the space kind of announcement this morning. Then just the same with Watch Night service. Like I said, we'll update you as soon as possible to say where the Watch Night service will take place. And then Christmas Day, on Sunday next week, will definitely be here in St. Nicholas Church, so you're still more than welcome to join the Christmas Day service. If you have family staying with you, please bring them along. We'll have a bit of a Christmas show and tell with Christmas gifts, so bring Christmas gifts if you want, not only for the kids, grown-ups can bring them as well. And if you feel festive and you want to wear a Christmas jumper, please do that. You'll be most welcome to join our Christmas service. On New Year's Day, we have our joint service with Broxburn Parish Church, and that's on New Year's Day at 11 a.m. in Broxburn Parish Church. So if you want to join us for that, you're also welcome to do that. So there will be no service here in St. Nicholas, and then our next service back here in St. Nicholas is on the 8th of January, and we'll have communion together. Then our weekly Bible reading plan, if you want to pick one up at the door. This week we've been reading Psalm 80 together, and this morning we're going to reflect on Psalm 80. And our Bible reading plan for every week is just a way for us to immerse ourselves in the Bible and to prepare ourselves for what we're going to be speaking about on a Sunday morning and reflecting together with it. And to know and to trust that God speaks to every one of us. So if you want to pick up one at the door, please do that. Then just a reminder that there will be no prayer meetings for those dates, the 21st, the 28th of December and the 4th of January. And the prayer meetings will restart again in the second week of January. If there is any urgent prayer requests, please contact Sheena or myself or any of the elders if you have any prayer requests over the coming weeks. It doesn't mean that we're not in touch. We can still be in touch. The prayer team just won't meet. I think that's everything. If I've forgotten something, please just remind me later again. I think that was also a mouthful. We're going to start our worship service here this morning. We're going to sing the beautiful hymn, O Little Town of Bethlehem, How Still We See You Lie. Above your deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in your dark street shining is everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in you tonight. So let us sing our hymn standing this morning, and let us praise and worship God together.
Silence starts.
On this fourth Sunday of Advent, we lit the candle for love with the candles of hope, joy, and peace. And we gather to reflect, to pray, and to worship our God, who looked at this world that he created out of love and chose to show us what love really is. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." So, dear friends, grace and peace to you from God our Father, through his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who was and is to come, and from the Holy Spirit, who in this Advent season wants to bring us the love, joy, peace, and hope of God today, and to let it live in our hearts forevermore. Amen. We're going to join in prayer together now. At the end of our opening prayer, we'll say the Lord's Prayer together, and the words will be on the screen for us to follow. So let us join our hearts and our minds together as one. Let us pray. Loving God, we gather in this season of promise to worship you and to sing your praise. We praise you for your love for us and for your faithfulness to us, for you are a God of promise. You never leave us or forsake us, for you are the source of all hope, and from you all joy springs. You are the one we expect, but your coming is always unexpected. You are the one who turns everything upside down, and you make all things new. God of love, we worship you, and we wait for you to awaken our wonder and astound us with your arrival again. You are present to us in a human child who could so easily not have lived to be a man. You are the invisible one, seen in a unique human face, inaccessible one, cradled in a human's arms, hidden one, revealed for all to see. You are perfect, pure, and holy, and you are caught up in all the dirt and danger and messiness of human life. And we are blessed beyond measure as a result. In and beyond the busyness of this Advent season, in and beyond the glitter and in and beyond the rush, when we are tired and frayed, when we lose sight of what it's really all about, when we put ourselves first and forget that you come to bring love, we pray that you will come close and restore us and forgive us. We are sorry if we try to keep you far away in heaven because it feels safer. We want a God who is stronger than we are, who can smite our enemies and magic our problems away. But yours is a different kind of power, and that scares us sometimes. So we tell lovely stories about Jesus' birth and ask our children to play the parts. If Herod gets a mention, it's only in passing, and we never dwell on the slaughter of hundreds of innocent children. But God of infinite compassion, we live in a world in which innocent children are dying every day. And if the stories of our faith have any truth in them, you are there, putting your life at risk along with theirs and weeping with their mothers when their worst fears are realized. You are part of our messy human families, where not all mothers are caring, and not all fathers are kind. You are present in every newborn child, healthy or not, wanted or not, privileged or poor. You come to us in everyone, challenging us to create a world in which every child can reach their full potential and take their place in your new creation. God, we do believe.
But we also pray, help us when our faith falls short, when we don't want to throw in our lot with you. Help us when our courage fails. And above all, stay with us, as you have promised that you will, wherever your way may lead us. Loving God, we pray that you will mend our broken hearts and help us to know ourselves to be forgiven and loved. Help us to watch and wait for you faithfully and truly all our days. All this we pray in the words that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This morning, as part of our what would be our all-age talk, I brought along the video that Wilson and some of the young people from the Busy Project created for their Busy Carol service last week in King's Church. And I asked them if we can watch it together as well, so that you can see what the young people have been up to this year. And they've created this beautiful video with the lyrics of Joy to the World. So we're going to watch that for the next few minutes. And just thanks be to God for the wonderful work that the Youth Project does in and among our young people, and to bring the message of Jesus to them. So let's enjoy this video.
Receive her key.
Joy indeed. Thank you so much for all the wonderful support that we do receive for the Busy Project as well, from each and every one of you, and for the prayers, and for all the volunteers that work really hard with them. We're going to sing our next hymn together, Christ is Coming, Let Creation. Going to ask Lynn to come to the front for us. She's going to read for us from Psalm 80.
Reading for us from Psalm 80, verses 1 to 7, and then verses 17 to 19. Hear us, Shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock. You who sit enthroned between the cherubim, shine forth before Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh. Awaken your might. Come and save us. Restore us, O God. Make your face shine on us, that we may be saved. How long, Lord God Almighty, will your anger smoulder against the prayers of your people? You have fed them with the bread of tears. You have made them drink tears by the bowlful. You have made us an object of derision to our neighbours, and our enemies mock us. Restore us, God Almighty. Make your face shine on us, that we may be saved. Let your hand rest on the man at your right hand, the Son of Man you have raised up for yourself. Then we will not turn away from you. Revive us, and we will call on your name. Restore us, Lord God Almighty. Make your face shine on us, that we may be saved. Amen.
Thank you, Lynn, for doing that reading for us. We're going to sing another hymn together, the beautiful hymn, 10,000 Reasons, and we're going to sing this standing if we're able.
Mm-hmm. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, worship Your holy name.
For the past three Sundays, we've been speaking about Advent and how we are waiting for Christmas to come. And while we are waiting, we're preparing for it. But Advent isn't just about preparing for Christmas, although, of course, in our culture, that's what December and increasingly November has become all about. In Advent, we go back to the Old Testament prophecies of the coming of the Messiah. And we try to imagine for ourselves waiting in expectation and longing for God to fulfill them. But in Advent, we also look forward to what the New Testament writers called in their own language the parousia, the appearing of Jesus Christ at the end of the age, and the time when he will come again in glory to judge both the living and the dead, and when his kingdom will reign forever, as our Apostles' Creed tells us. And it's really appropriate that Psalm 80 is our psalm for today. Perhaps it didn't fall so nicely on our ears this morning, because it is a psalm of longing, a psalm of almost a kind of a desperation. The psalm is all about being revived, being brought back to life, being renewed and being restored. And the psalm has been read in many times of revival in the past, times of great spiritual power in the history of the church, when the Holy Spirit seemed to work in a special way among the people of God. Revivals often led Christian people to share their faith with their neighbors so that new people would come to faith in Christ. But the revivals didn't usually start there. They started with a reawakening of faith in the hearts and lives of Christian people. And that's what Advent is supposed to be all about. The sentiment of revival, the sentiment of being restored, the sentiment of being renewed. And throughout the psalm, we hear it three times. Verse 3 says, "Restore us, O God, make your face shine on us, that we may be saved." This is repeated in verse 7 again, and then again in verse 19, where it says, "Restore us, Lord God Almighty. Make your face shine on us, so that we may be saved." In some of the verses we didn't read this morning, in verse 14, we also find a very interesting phenomenon. If you go home this afternoon, please do go read it again so that you hear what the rest of the psalm also says. It says, "Return to us, God Almighty. Return to us." And the word "return" here stands for a Hebrew word that we often translate with the word "repent," to turn around, to come back, to do a 180. And normally in the Bible, when we read the word "repent," it is applied to us as humans, that we are being called to turn away from our sins and to turn back to God. But occasionally, like here in Psalm 80, in the Old Testament, it is used for God. God is said to change his mind and to repent of his anger toward his people. And that's what the people of God are praying about when they are praying the psalm. We can almost hear them saying, "God, your face is turned away from us. Won't you turn back to us? Won't you look upon us again?" And this ties with the second part of the phrase that is used in the second half of this verses that are repeated, to make your face shine on us that we might be saved. We can almost paraphrase this and say to God, "God, won't you smile on us again? It's been so long since we've seen your smile." And I suspect we all know that feeling and what that feels like. Sometimes we might go to a close friend and ask them, how are you? And they'll reply and they say, oh, well, you know, I've had better days. We can all identify with this feeling in one way or another. For us, many of our churches are struggling and they look back nostalgically to the days when the pews were full and they were big Sunday schools who provided lovely nativities on the Sunday before Christmas. We long for those good old days. And for us as individuals too, there are many times when God seems a long way away from us. We might go through financial struggles and problems at work, maybe even a loss of a job or a livelihood. Many of us are feeling the effects of advancing age. We go through debilitating illnesses. We lose people we love, and we have worries about our kids and our grandchildren. And maybe we go through family conflicts and heartache. And we can say, yes, we've seen better days. In Psalm 80, in the verses we didn't read, the community reminds God of those better days. Israel was like a grape vine that God brought up out of Egypt and planted in the good land of Canaan, verses 8 to 16 tell us. And the people filled the country and they flourished. And for many years it seemed God was really blessing them. But then we can read what has happened. Verses 12 to 13 say, why have you broken down its walls so that all who pass by pluck off its grapes? The wild boar of the forest has ravaged it, and the beasts of the field have gazed on it. It sounds like one of those invasions that took place in the 8th or the 6th century before Christ, when God's people were defeated in battle and many of them were taken away into exile. And we can imagine for ourselves that the writer of the psalm is standing in the ruins of Samaria or Jerusalem and looking around and shaking his head, God, why have you done this to us? Why have you abandoned us? We are your flock and you are our shepherd. We are your vine and you are the owner of the vineyard, but where are you? How can you have let this happen to us? Other passages in the Old Testament give a kind of an explanation for this. They talk about how Israel turned away from God to worship false gods and to practice injustice and oppression. But this psalm doesn't go there. It doesn't assign blame, or if it does, it throws the blame on God. We can almost hear the anger in the people's voices. God, where are you? How come you didn't come to help us? Please come now and rescue us from this desperate situation that we're in. How long are we going to have to wait for you? So we can imagine for ourselves, perhaps we can ask, what an almost desperate psalm like this, a kind of a depressing psalm like this, can mean for us today. And from it, I want to take three things for us, which I think the psalm is calling us to. The first thing is that I think the psalm is calling us to pray. The psalms are a prayer book of the people of God. And sometimes we even can use them as prayers for ourselves or as a model of what prayer can look like for us. We don't have to be afraid to tell God what we are feeling. For the Psalms encourage us not to be afraid. It encourages us to pray about everything, and it speaks to us when we can't seem to find the words. Secondly, I think the psalm is also calling us to turn. In verse 14, the people beg God to turn back to them. Turn to us and let us see your smile again, like we've said. But this turning is always a two-way street. We hear the people say, "Restore us, O God of hosts." But this also means for us that we need to be open for God to restore us. We need to turn back to God ourselves. Sometimes we struggle to change. Sometimes it's a little bit difficult for us to be honest and realistic in prayer. Sometimes change is really hard for us to make. If it's something like trying to lose weight or trying to change to not have such a bad temper, or the change of learning patience, or the change of being more careful about how we talk to other people. Those habits that come so naturally for us are sometimes deep ruts that are difficult for us to change. And sometimes our hope to change is set in our own ability to do things differently. But if we're really honest, it's not going to get us very far, because it is only our humanness that makes it so difficult for us to change. So the psalm acknowledges that we can't do this on our own. We need God's help. When you could almost hear the people asking God and begging God, make us turn around. It's not asking God to do something that we should do ourselves. It is a humble acknowledgement that if we want to change our lives, our human strength just isn't up to the job. We need to come to God in desperation and in faith and cry out for his help. So the psalm encourages us to pray, and it calls us to turn our turn back to God. Finally, the psalm also encourages us to hope. In this psalm, we read of a foreshadowing that is to come. We hear about a man that God has raised at his right hand. And if we look carefully, we can see it almost being one of those Old Testament predictions of Jesus coming. It encourages us to put our hope in him. In the psalm, we find a few of the metaphors that Jesus himself, when he did come, claims of himself. The first is that we read in verse 1, that the people pray, "Hear us, O Shepherd of Israel." In the Old Testament, the shepherd was a metaphor for a king. But in the New Testament, we know that Jesus calls himself the Good Shepherd. He says in John 10 that, "I am the Good Shepherd, and the Good Shepherd lays down his life for his sheep." And he talks about calling his sheep by name, leading them out and guiding them and feeding them. In Psalm 23, we also hear that David prays, "The Lord is my shepherd." In the New Testament, Jesus is this Lord, the ultimate good shepherd. So when the people pray, "Make your face to shine on us, O God," we know that Jesus is the answer to that prayer. The psalm also talks about Israel as God's vine, planted in the land to produce good fruit. In the New Testament, we see that Jesus says of himself again, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener." In the Old Testament, the prophets talked about God looking for good fruit on his vine, but only finding bitter grapes. But Jesus is the fruitful vine, and he says to us, "Abide in me as I abide in you." To abide somewhere means to make that your home. So we make our spiritual home with Jesus. We live in fellowship with him. We listen to his words and we put them into practice. And with his help, we can produce the fruit that God is looking for. The third and the last metaphor that we see in the psalm for Jesus is the Son of Man. In verse 17 it says, "Let your hand rest on the man at your right hand, the Son of Man that you have raised up for yourself." In the original context, this is a metaphor for Israel. Israel is God's firstborn son. But again, in the Gospels, we see that Jesus takes this upon himself and he uses it for himself. And it becomes one of his favorite ways of talking about himself, that he is the Son of God. He is the one who shows up and shows us what it means, not just to be God, but also to be truly human. So when we look at Jesus, we're looking at what God's dream of what a human life is like. And as we make our home in him, it is possible for us to pray and to turn around, to truly love and to truly be faithful to God. We started this morning by saying God loved this world so much that he gave us his one and only Son. And this is God's love for us, that he comes to us and that he listens to us when we read a psalm like this and when we pray that he will restore us and that he will turn his back to us. So the psalm calls us to pray, not only as individuals, but also as a community. And we can pray, even if we pray as desperate people. People who realize that life can sometimes be too much for us, and that we aren't up to the task all by ourselves, and that we need God's help. And that we can pray as people of faith, because we believe in a God who loves us. The psalm also calls us to turn, and it calls us to ask for God's help as we turn back to him. We can sometimes get distracted by too many things, and sometimes our lives are consumed by stuff that's got nothing to do with loving God and loving our neighbor. So we ask God to help us to turn from that and turn back to him. And in Advent, it is a time for us to spend time in prayer, to spend time with God, to focus on him, and to look at the life of Jesus, to see his human face. For in him, God has shown the light of his countenance to us, as the old translation says. He has made his face to shine upon us. We've seen God smile on us in the life of Jesus. We're called to remember him, to turn back to him, and to follow where he leads us. So as we prepare for the coming of Christmas, as we prepare for the coming of Jesus Christ, may we hear his voice, the Good Shepherd calling each of us by name, and may we see him smile on us and trust that he loves us. Amen. We're going to sing our next hymn together, Jesus, Name Above All Names. Let us join our hearts and our minds together as one. Let us pray. God of love, hope, peace, and joy, you are faithful. Your love for us never ends. In Jesus, you have shown us love beyond our understanding, and you never give up on us. As we pray now, Lord, we pray that you would hear our prayers for the world, for the church, and for one another. We pray, Lord, come, Lord Jesus, into the darkness of our world, a world where there is injustice, war, tension between people, where many people still lack the basics of food and clean water. We pray, come, Lord Jesus, into the uncertain future of the current state of affairs, as we progress to Christmas and look beyond to a new year and not knowing what it may hold for us. We pray, come, Lord Jesus, into our communities, where many are struggling with the cost of living crisis, struggling to heat their homes in the cold weather, and with debt, and for those for whom food banks have become a lifeline. We pray, come, Lord Jesus, come into our lives and into the lives of those for whom we are concerned. We pray, bring your comfort to the bereaved, and to those who are struggling to cope with life on their own. We pray, come, Lord Jesus, and give reassurance where there is fear, confidence where there is doubt, wherever people are hurting, come and let your light shine. We thank you also, Lord, for all that you have blessed us with, and we dedicate our offerings to you and ask that you will guide our church to use it to build your kingdom here on earth. As we now face a new week ahead of us, with Christmas at the end of it, we pray, come, Lord Jesus, come. We ask this through the work of your Holy Spirit in our hearts. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen. Our closing hymn for this morning is the beautiful hymn, Strength Will Rise As We Wait Upon the Lord, As We Wait Upon the Lord, As We Wait Upon the Lord. Let us stand and sing this hymn together. as we go out and face this new week, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you and all whom you love, this day and forevermore. Amen.